Okay, good day and welcome everybody to this presentation on digital identity and the dark side of digital identity. I'm going to share some stories and some cases on where digital identity goes wrong. And before I do that, I'll give a brief introduction of myself. My name is Henk Marsman. I work with Rabobank, which is a top three bank in the Netherlands. There I'm responsible for workforce identity and access management. So basically all the services we provide to our employees for authentication, authorization, privileged access, and the likes. However, the majority of the presentation that I'm going to share today is taken from my second, well, it's not really a job, a full-time job, but I'm also liaised with the University of Leiden here in the Netherlands. And I'm doing some preparatory work, which hopefully will lead to a full research into digital identity. And as part of that preparatory work, I've been reading up over the past year on digital identity, and then not as much the workforce digital identity, but more into customer identity, citizen identity, national digital identity solutions, and the likes. And that means that I'm not talking about Rabobank and where Rabobank is at, also not where university is at, but I'm going to echo a lot of research and studies that are out there and trying to put that in the lens of us as a professional community working on digital identity, taking into the aspect of inclusion and making sure that the solutions that we deliver operate in a bigger whole and that they are right. So in that sense, I'm giving here also some personal reflections on this topic. For that, I created a agenda to look at digital identity as we see it, also the things that go wrong with it, and then moving on, what are the challenges that that are related there and how to address them. So to start off with the first topic, as you are all interested in digital identity, otherwise the chances are slim that you attend an event like this, I still want to give a brief setting the scene here. I think this report is known by most, and it was the report that really put digital identity on the map, in the sense that the Global McKinsey Institute did a research, and that was already in 2019, where they did an analysis of digital society, digital economy, the benefits of it. And they noted that the key to digital benefits in this whole world was the digital identity. And that was actually keeping a lot of participants back. If you don't have a digital identity, it's difficult to engage in digital services, to reap the benefits of it. So they made projections stating that from 3% up to 13% of GDP could be gained, could be added if you get digital identity done right. And that put this topic absolutely on the map. Was it not on the map prior to 2019? No. Identity and digital identity have been subject of attention, I think, ever since we went digital, when internet technology became more pervasive in society. So also the World Bank is engaged on this topic, especially for development purposes and countries in development settings. They support these countries in digital identity initiatives, and they call this ID for development. So what the World Bank does there is share knowledge and experience on digital identity projects, how to get it right, and also how to make sure that these are inclusive. Now, I'll get back to that later. And if you take even one step further back, digital identity also fits into global goals of the United Nations. And the Sustainable Development Goals formulated by the United Nations as an objective to be achieved by 2030 includes really goals to improve sustainability, to develop in a sustainable way. So goal number 16 is all about peace, justice, and strong institutions. That's something that at least I, in my position, living in a wealthy country with strong institutions, rarely think about. But that's not not common if you look at it from a global perspective. And as a sub for that goal, sub 9, is that they want to provide legal identity to everyone, including birth registration. And why is that? Well, at the moment, it's being estimated that still roughly 1 billion people globally don't have a legal identity. So when they walk up to a counter to open a bank account and I would bring my passport, these people would have nothing, not a birth certificate, not a voter ID, not a passport. They're simply not registered, and they were never registered. There was no need for it. But increasingly, we see that this registration is required to aid that development. And as part of this identity registration, this legal identity topic, also digital identity is one way to achieve that. Obviously, there is quite a lot to it to get it to a legal identity. And I've also seen cases where digital identity was being inserted instead of legal identity. I don't believe that is what should be done, but it is part of this big topic that is increasingly getting attention on how to do digital identity right, all the way from the United Nations down. Now, governments are active there, but also the financial sector, so the banking industry where I have my daytime job. Recently, the GAIN initiative was announced, which is undersigned by 150 participants out of the industry of open standards, technology, and banking. And what GAIN aims to do is, in a sense, not a new idea, but they're also looking at this issue of trust, how to gain trust online, how to provide trusted digital identities. And why not position the banks as a role for that? Taking two lines of reasoning. One is that in most countries, or at least in the country where I live, almost everybody has a bank account, and having a bank account means going through KYC procedures, so you are known, means getting an authentication solution, being able to log into your online bank account, doing online payments. So why not expand that to digital identity? Because a lot of the critical mass is already there. And the other line of reasoning goes like this. Banks are trusted institutions. Historically, they took care of your gold and silver. Now they do that in a digital way for your finances. Tie that into the reasoning that data is the new gold, and your identity data might be something that they should store in a safe as well. And actually, that line of reasoning has already evolved. I don't expect that will be a safe at the bank that actually keeps track of your identity. We're much more looking into the area of wallets, but this GAIN initiative is formulating this, like, can we get traction in the financial industry to come up with a solution that will provide trusted digital identities in the digital society, all with the aims of improving socioeconomic inclusion, reducing fraud, and basically looking at the benefits that were stated in the McKinsey report and also in quite some other reports. However, digital identity does not always go right. And I've got some cases that I want to share with you, and then take one step back again from these cases and see what this means. So the first person that I'd like you to meet is this person. He's mentioned in a report. His name is Okiye. And as part of a program that his government is running to identify everybody and provide everybody with a digital identity, he was requested to enroll. OKEA is over 80 years old, doesn't have that much documentation. So in terms of legal identity, cannot really prove who he is. So what happens in those type of situations is that you have people that can vouch for you, like an elder from your village, or through interrogation, they figured out, you know, during which reign of which ruler were you alive? What events do you recollect? Where did your parents live, and etc. However, for OKEA, the registration official had doubts, and they classified him as being 60 years old based on their assessment, what they could know. And as part of providing him with his digital identity, then also his biometrics are captured and he gets an ID card. Now, the problem here is that OKEA is not 60. He is actually 80, and he is entitled by that age to retirement, so a pension. So what happened in this situation, and this is one case, but this is where digital identity being provided to a person registers him in a different way than he himself says in terms of age. And basically he loses his social benefits, and he has to wait another 5 years before he can get his first pension. And this is one case that is mentioned in a report of a study that was done in Uganda, and the report got the title "Chased Away and Left to Die." And I must say that looking at this case, there's the question on to what extent is it actually digital identity, because it intermixes with general physical identity registration and enrollment. But this is the program ran in Uganda. It's called Nadaga Muntu, and everybody will get a digital identity. And what they found out that on the one hand, they're rolling out this program, and also those services are already requiring this digital identity to make use of these services. On the other hand, not everybody is enrolled yet. And that's where the clash comes. So OKEA is one case where you see the registration is off, which immediately leads to not being able to get social benefits. Another person in this case was Rebecca, who was pregnant, in need of medical assistance, goes to the hospital, and she's not being helped. And that's where the quote came from. She literally stated in the interview with the researcher that she was chased away and left to die. Why? Because at the time of registration, she was not present in her area. So she didn't get registered for this digital identity, this national identity. Traveling to the capital was very time consuming, and she never made the time for it, also partly not by understanding what the impact might be. So she didn't have this national identity card. And then at the hospital, the nurses told her, well, you need to get your digital identity, your national identity card, before we can help you. Also as part of the transcript of that interview, it stated that in the end she was able to approach some younger nurses who had more compassion still, and she was being helped. But this really illustrates that when identity and also digital identity is not done right, in combination with closing up services exclusively based on that type of identification, so actually having the situation where there's a physical human being on the other side of the table, but he's not in the administration, and therefore computer says, no, we don't know you, so we can't help you. That really has impact, huge impact. And there are more cases known. I won't go into detail them, but this gives a bit of a perspective saying, we want to get this digital identity topic done right because of a lot of benefits to be gained. But it's not always that easy, and things not always go right. You can't prevent everything, but we definitely need to address these things because people actually get hurt. And another report by Access Now, which is a group that looks at development and technology and human rights, they presented a number of what they call big ID myths. So stories that are on the upside and the positive and the bright side, let's give everybody a digital identity and then problems will be solved. they unravel them and they give some examples. And they took two examples from Aadhaar. Aadhaar is the unique identification program in India that had really great results, registered a population of over 1.3 million billion people in a couple of years, capturing biometrics, providing them with a unique registration, and that's increasingly being used for services. But next to the benefits that are gained there, you see that this identity comes up and services are closing down. And when these two come together and don't match, that's when the problems begin. And one illustration that they gave was in the Jharkhand province, where they saw that people were registered, biometrics were taken, but when people do hard manual labor, sometimes the biometrics are altered. Huh? So your fingerprints will fade away if you're in a brick company, which means that when rations are being supplied, they were not recognized by the system. So registration went right, but the recognition at the point of the service failed. So these people basically didn't get rations. And another case where it ties into actually citizenship was in the province of Assam, where this digital identity solution was also used to capture attributes of people in the country and excluding certain ethnic and religious groups from services or even citizenship. And these have been cases that have gone there up to the High Court, because this is where digital identity, which can be seen as kind of a technical rollout to register people, rolls up through the services actually into the rights of citizens and residents and who is registered as what. And what specifically struck me in reading through this is that this happens in general and we need to address this, because this is not right. This is the dark side of digital identity where it can go wrong. But women are even one step further behind because of a number of reasons. Most of them are culturally and contextually, but for example, the second barrier that I have on this slide, for example, is access. Just having the time to get this digital identity, where in households in some areas, the husband is working, and when he comes at home, he expects the home to be clean, but the wife, the woman is also working, but also needs to take care of the household and the kids. So she doesn't even have time to get registered. The same with societal expectations. And so what is expected in terms of roles of men and women and who should get this digital identity. There was one case here that that was highlighted where they saw that refugees, when they got registered, the women and the men both got a digital identity, which was quite new, because up to that time, the women was actually under the man and had to go through the man in all these type of activities. So she got more autonomy, could decide for herself, for example, where to spend household money, how to get education for the children, because now she had this voice, this representation in sense of a digital identity. But at the same time, they also noticed an increase in domestic violence, because some of the men didn't appreciate the women having their own opinion. So this also gets in the mix. And what I really appreciate here is that also in identity, we have a group called Women in Identity. They're specifically also looking at these aspects. And it's important to be also sensible to that part of digital identity when we talk about where do people fall in the cracks and are there specific groups being excluded. And I listed a number of topics because it sometimes feels a bit as a hidden field of study, but digital identity truly is global and every government is active with it. And every area, so to speak, is looking into it and trying to find the optimal solution. And here are just a few of these cases. It's not restricted to a continent to the global north or the global south. Everybody is engaged. I partially mention here the topic of biometrics. That's a whole different topic in itself. So digital identity can go wrong, can go terribly wrong, up to the level of actually physical harm to people. So this is where digital identity comes very close to protection of humans, of human rights, of equality, of inclusion, obviously also of privacy. So what are these challenges then, looking back at some of these cases? Those are presented here on this slide, and it's not a final evaluated study. It's an ongoing list, but one of the things in the execution of digital identity projects is that sometimes is the programmatic push is very present. So we register, we roll out once, we capture everybody, we make sure it works, and the operations after the fact is sometimes ignored or does not get sufficient attention. So for example, in one country where they registered everybody in a period of 2 years, then the issued digital identity and their related card had a validity of 10 years, and then it had to be renewed. So now they're looking into this huge renewal program, and actually nobody counted on that. Maybe they should have spread some processes are not optimized for that big load. So they might go into another programmatic approach. Well, actually it's more of an ongoing registration of people. Sometimes it's also done standalone, so not connected to the ecosystem that it's part of. And especially when this is done in respect to also achieving legal identity. Legal identity means tied into a legal framework, into an existing registration part or whole of your population. So for that, I also gave a brief overview of a CVRS, as they call it, Civil Registration and Vital Statistics. That's actually what it boils down to, a population register. So capturing everybody in your country, registering childs at birth, keeping track of population development. And the term statistics is in there, but it's actually extremely important for a government to know what the population consists of in terms of planning for healthcare, in terms of government budgeting, basically in terms of managing your country. And digital identity is part of it as well. But if you don't connect these two, they're going to be running apart, and results will be suboptimal. Now, also, some of these initiatives have been started out of a national security perspective, for example. So registering people to get control, to be able to protect your borders. And that is not an incentive to include everybody and make sure it works for the people in the country. So that's also where these things go off. And there can be a lack of a legal framework. For example, that was the case in Kenya, where the national identity registration needs to kind of be reassessed through a privacy impact assessment. And also, and the last one I want to highlight on this space is that last mile effort. So when we look at the population with commercial glasses on, like a company, it's okay to capture most of people because the most profit is made by 20-30% of the population. Going into the long tail means that the effort will exceed the benefit. So from a commercial perspective, that's often not done. But from a government perspective, the government and the role of the state in that sense is to take care of the country and every resident and citizen in there. So they do have an incentive to do that last mile, to make sure that also persons who are difficult to reach, don't know how to read and write, have no electricity, are still able to participate in society, and that their rights to, for example, social benefits, but also to voting, to property, are protected in these systems. So those are some of the challenges. And then when we look at that, it's not new in that sense. You know, the World Bank has already been working on principles for identification. So these principles are already, how do you call it, written down. They are present, but it's still a matter of finding them in every identity project that is going on, and then applying them properly. And the same goes for frameworks. For example, this one is developed by the Center for Internet and Society in India. Once again, because Aadhaar is one of the largest biometric and digital identification programs we have in this world. And this framework is looking specifically at the legal aspects of it. So the rule of law, rights and risks are subject to an evaluation. And the interesting part here is that even though this is kind of developed based on one instance, they're now testing it in Africa in a few pilots on digital identity solutions there. Again, with the aim to make sure that what is being delivered there also has a legal framework, that the legal framework is right, that it's covering every aspect. Because also in some of these cases, we see that, you know, registration is one. But for example, if I get registered and there's a typo in my last name, or I get registered as a German citizen instead of a Dutch citizen, for example. Cases that happen, especially in the refugee context, in emergency aid, Red Cross type of context, then there's not always a process to correct it. And that can be really a challenge. That should be part of the system as a whole, this feedback loop. So when I bring it together, I think there are at least three aspects to doing it better. Taking this perspective on kind of a global scale, digital identity, digital society. And I think the first question is asking why. Because a lot of these programs start up and immediately, well, not always immediately, but often step into the practicalities of registering people, finding a solution that works. But taking one step back and asking, why are we doing this? Is this for surveillance purposes? Because that will give a whole different system than if it's for protecting people's rights, making sure that everybody can vote, for example. Then the second part is that applying principles, and there are principles available, taking time to pick up these principles and apply them to the specific context and the specific situation of a large-scale digital identity program. And the last part is to take also a holistic perspective. And by that I mean that digital identity is not just issuing a card or an app on a phone to a person. Holistic means that if it's an app on a phone, there needs to be a phone, connection, internet, electricity, so a stable infrastructure. People need to know how to use such devices, have an idea of the impact. But also if it ties into your identity and representation, for example, in court, so the legal identity, there's a relationship with the population register, with the legal framework that is present in a specific jurisdiction. And also this digital identity in itself is not going to do much. The digital identity becomes of value when it's being used in combination to obtain a service or to obtain something valuable. So you also need a lot of services that accept the digital identity. So that's also part of this bigger picture on digital identity. And I'm not saying that we as a professional community, you watching online or being physically present, can solve this all at once. But having this perspective at least makes sure that we consider it and that we might consider different aspects on the digital identity activities that we do. And that's important because, as I said in the beginning, we need to get this right. And right is actually, well, almost a philosophical term. Eh? I used Mr. Aristotle here to say, but what are people entitled to? And what is right? What are your rights and your freedoms? Because digital identity is touching these. And technology is neither good nor bad, but also not neutral. So the way that we develop this, and the way that we look at this, is important. And I'm also going to give you the actual quote, because then we are talking about more philosophical terms like honor and what we deserve. And I think for us in the current day and age, there are declarations on human rights. There are ways in which the state, it positions itself. And we can do digital identity in that context and make sure that the solutions that are being built at least are future-proof, are inclusive, are protective of our data, and actually making it a better world. With that, I want to leave you. There is the room for Q&A, either when you're physically attending the conference and looking at my presentation, or if you're attending virtually in the chat. You can reach me on both of my identities if you want to, or through LinkedIn. I'm happy to continue the conversation with you, and I hope this presentation gave an additional insight on digital identity to you all. So thank you for your time and attention.